sticking to it.
That's who is Brian Vollmer in 2 minutes. Well, we're finding out more who Brian Vollmer actually is over these series of shows that we're doing. And Brian always humors me once a month to get on here with me and lets me bust his chops. And we talk about Helix and his journey through the world of music. Here he is. This is Brian Vollmer from London, Ontario right now. There you are, buddy.
So I'm pretty excited there. Good to be here, Ken. You don't bust my chops.
You've had a busy week, man.
Yeah, you've been all over the place. Getting ready for, you said, two acoustic dates coming up and having numerous practices. We have Caleb Duck, as you know, playing for us. He's come back and... Mike Hackman and drums, so it's gonna be a good show.
Should be a fun show. And you were in Detroit today.
I was in Detroit and down picking up Tess Presley. It was a good thing too because the song order was incorrect, so I'll have to get that corrected tomorrow. And that's why you get Tess Presley. So
it's an exciting time for you right now, and the band's busy.
I got my my new old solo album, you could say, long story, coming out in vinyl. We have these two acoustic dates this weekend. Next weekend we're in Edmonton with Loverboy and Honeymoon Suite and Rough Trade and Carol Pope, Kiss My Whip. And at 6 o'clock in the afternoon, it's a big street party, I guess, in the middle of the street. So I like Edmonton. Wow. Love Alberta.
So a busy time then for you.
It is. And, you know, of course, I got an Airbnb. I work in that. And my own house here, even though we moved from Planet Helix about 3 years ago, we still haven't completely finished this house the way we want it. So, you know, constantly working on all those things. And then, you know, putting out shorts. Basically, I'm a publicist here when I'm at home. Get up in the morning, I do my... daily physical routine and walk my animals and do that sort of thing. And then basically hit the computer, as you know, because you taught me a lot of stuff.
A few things, maybe.
Well, we've been doing shorts to help the acoustic show, but these shows are a real learning process, as we found out, from buying tickets to advertising to doing publicity to... you know, finding which halls have the best deal. In other words, you know, a nice venue, what's the cost? Are there any extras tagged on? You know, it can get very costly to rent these halls. So,
I know we're talking about stuff that's going on current. So, I mean, when you think about that whole thing, that whole process of going through and booking, you know, booking these shows, how does that feel compared to the old days?
From a perspective.
Well, I mean, back in the old days, you guys would go play big gigs on the bar circuit, for example, right?
Yeah, but we didn't book those ourselves. We had an agency.
Right. So you had an agency. So the difference this time around, you're the agency.
I'm the agent, promoter, chief bottle washer, diaper changer.
Right.
Jack of all trades. You have to do that to survive. All these people that are out there in the circuit doing the same thing I'm doing, only maybe on a, I shouldn't say a more minor scale. Helix is probably a bigger band profile-wise, but bands like Sarah Smith, Doug Vardy, the Mudmen, Zedd, they all go into these 150, 250 seat halls, and they can make money and survive because, you know, the bar scene has gotten pretty hurting.
Yeah, it's a crazy, crazy world that we live in. No doubt about that. I mean, lots of stuff going on. You, when we talk about, you know, the fact that you've got to do all this work, you're like a jack of all trades and master of some, or you're learning and you learn from other people.
We have to survive. You have to learn how to promote a show. You have to learn about selling tables to corporate entities, you know, to fill your
right
venue, for instance. Like I remember talking to, God, name is Casey. I used to run the blues club downtown, but he had a John Newman Art where he had like so many tables. There were so many companies he rented to. He had the names of all the companies out, the tables, little booklets.
Oh, you're thinking about, are you thinking about the London Music Club?
No, I'm thinking about the Lead Bellies.
Okay.
Blues.
It's a different way of going about doing things and booking these shows.
Actually, it's come full circle. This is what I'm going to be writing about in my book, The Golden Age of Canadian Bar Circuit, that back in 1965, that's all it was happened there.
You just lost a light, I think, but
yeah, we still just lost what the hell happened?
I don't know. Your internet's okay, your internet's strong, and your lighting's not bad.
No, my screen's just went black.
Uh-oh. So you can't see me right now?
No, I can't see nothing.
Well, just keep looking at the screen.
Can you see me?
Yep, keep looking at your camera. I can see you great. Just keep going.
Okay, all right. Well, anyway, where were we? Back in 1965, bands didn't play bars. They played one-nighters. They played high schools, colleges, universities, roller skating rinks, dance halls. A lot of times they put these gigs on themselves. In fact, a lot of times it was their buddy from high school that would book the band and stuff, and those people went on to become agents and stuff. From their booking their buddy's band as a high school band. But in around 1975, what happened was the liquor laws changed in Canada. They dropped the drinking age from 21 to 18, and suddenly there was 3 years, gone, 3 years of people that could get into bars that had previously been staying in bars. And it was bonanza for bar owners. And the biggest comment I got from people that were around that period of time, like Tom Wasikowski from Stratford, he'd say, if you could blow a harmonica and keep time with tapping your foot, you're in. And there was a bar on every corner.
When they dropped the age to 18 for drinking, it changed everybody's lives, and there were a lot more people going out for live music to clubs.
And that was the other thing. There was only live music. What else could you do at that time of night? TV was
right.
11.
Live music was the place to go.
There was no such thing as video, VHS, computers, telephones were like rotary.
Right.
I remember we were first on the road, phoning home was like an ordeal because we had no money. So, of course, we had the system worked out where, you know, you'd phone home, collect, and you'd say, yeah, this is Barney Flintstone. And they'd turn down the call and then they'd phone back, you know, or something like that.
Oh man, that's funny. You know, I mean, I look back to that those days, and I mean, we used to always look forward to Helix coming to town. Whether you guys played at the John Scott or the Weed Sheaves, or the Schooner Inn, there were three different bars that you guys played sometimes when you came here.
Yeah.
And not always the same time. Sometimes it was just one of those places, and we always look forward to an evening to Ranch and Roll.
Well, usually we stuck with one bar until, you know, something happened to that bar. Like, I think we played the John Scott for the longest time, and then the John Scott closed up or something. I don't know what happened.
Yeah.
Scott. Yep. And then we went to the, I think the Schooner, and then we went to the Wheat Sheaves.
Yeah, and you've got video footage from some of those dates too, right, that go way back.
I had footage from the Wheat Sheaves. I wish I would have went outside because it was a house.
I know. And a friend of mine, William House, was the owner.
Oh, really? Is the house still there? Is it still there?
And William actually lives around the corner from me, William and Chris. Christine, yeah. So
I'd have to go take a picture of that place.
I should actually get them to come over one day you're over here so you can meet them.
Well, I'm going to be talking about some of those things when we do the show on Sunday, the afternoon show, the storytelling show.
Right.
An intimate afternoon with Helix, acoustic songs and storytelling.
Right.
And we'll also be focusing a lot on Paul Hackman, who, as you know, was from St. Thomas.
Right.
Paul always referred to St. Thomas as Little Chicago.
Right. Would there have been, or will there be a story about a cigarette machine getting dragged down the street?
Probably. We'll probably talk about that. Well, that's the story about the Schooner you're referring to. We've told the story between us several times, right? But we'll tell as many, you know, that's the nice thing about this show is that every place we go, we can really change the stories because we got almost a story for every town. Like, I go to Stratford and base the whole show around just talking about Stratford. And some of those songs, same thing with St. Thomas, London, Toronto. Because there were so many stories, there were so many things happened to us. So they still continue to happen to this day, for that matter.
Right. So when you and I are talk last, we were like still around 1979. You're getting, you know, the lineup that's going to take you into the 80s now. Paul Hackman's joined the band. All that stuff has happened. You guys have recorded your very first album at Springfield Sound, right?
Yes.
And that album is called Breaking Loose, and you sold a bunch of copies of that, and then you guys played four dates in Texas, right?
I believe, yeah, we played four dates in Texas, Helotes, Dallas, Houston, and not San Antonio, Amarillo, because Helotes, San Antonio.
And tell me how well were you guys received in Texas?
Oh, great. In Amarillo, we couldn't believe it. We drove around all day long. We were getting airplay on the college station, but it didn't matter to us. We were like, we just couldn't believe it. We were just...
Yeah, you guys were like a household name in Texas. People loved you there.
Well, it was mostly due to two people. It was Joe Anthony out of San Antonio, who played us in Kiss K-Mac.
Right.
He controlled that whole friggin' marketplace. And then there was Chris Johnson from the Amarillo College. And they just give us so much airplay. And so people in Texas knew who we were, and especially through Joe. And we did our first ever tour down there, and we came back. And as Brent says when he talks about Billy Oxygen, he said, we went to Texas, we came back, as far as our friends were concerned, we were stars, you know. And
so you guys were having that rocky moment.
Yeah, like, we came back, I remember we were young kids, really, at that point, and...
Who was the oldest in the band at that time? Would you remember who was the oldest?
It'd be Paul, for sure.
Okay, and so you guys were like, were you guys early 20s there by that time?
Oh, let's see. That was Well, that was in 1980. I'm sorry, we went down in 79, I believe. The album was right. 79. Can't remember if we went in 81 or I think it was 80.
Did you guys go there in 79 in support of the album?
I'm swaying towards 79 because Brian Duran was in the band still. Right. And so anyway, it was 1979. So how old would I have been? 64 years ago.
That's a long time ago.
Yeah. That doesn't seem right.
No,
we're doing the math wrong.
Oh, no, man.
A year less, sorry. 21 plus 23,
44. Yeah, 44 years ago.
44.
I was thinking about
the math in the week of subject.
The math wasn't working for me there, but
I'm back.
But next year, is
a long day.
Next year, 2024, will mark 50 years of Helix since it came into existence. That's a big milestone.
Huh?
That's a big milestone.
I guess. I don't think of it like that. I just think of the next 10 years, how am I going to get through it?
Helix celebrates the big 5-0 next year. That'd be kind of cool. Maybe a big party is in order for that one.
Yeah, I guess. It's a selling point. Well, it's a selling point for sure, right?
Yep. No doubt. No doubt.
All shows you could base around that.
You are getting good at this. You're figuring all this stuff out, and I love the fact that you are a learner. So tell me, if you were giving advice to someone young, wanting to work in the music industry, what would you say to them about learning?
Oh, there's so much. But there is. First off, you know, you start with your morals. You got to be honest. Do your words, your bond. Doesn't matter what's on a piece of paper. But, you know, in regards to what you're just talking about, it isn't really me. I'm not such a smart guy. In fact, I always try to surround myself with smarter people than I am because I want to learn from them. I don't want to surround my people by people who are going to kiss my ass or blow smoke up my ass or say yes every time I fart and all that shit. I want people, but at the same time, you know, I want people there just to put the knife in and twist it either. But, you know, like you teach me stuff. You know, when I go to, I go to Brent still for advice and different stuff. I still talk to my ex-manager, Bill Sykes, sometimes about stuff.
You know, I got to tell you, when I was at your place yesterday, I was talking to Linda. We were talking about it. I said, you know, I wish Brian and I had become friends so much sooner back in the day, because you know, I feel like I've known you a long time already.
Well, it's nice to know.
Yeah. I certainly value your friendship, Brian. I really value the fact that you trusted IndieTunz Records.
Thanks.
With your music. That is a big honor for me.
Well, I could see how much energy you had, and you seemed to be sincerely motivated by the love of music and the love of wanting to work with me. So, you know, I some things you just got to feel. Not always saying you're right, but, you know, like most of the time they got pretty good feel of people. And I don't know, I just felt we would have a nice working relationship together, and we both were motivated by the correct things.
Yeah, and that's the relationship I go for with all the artists that I work with, you know, I'm hoping that as you and I work together, it becomes a really great working model for the other artists that are on the label as well, because there's some really, really great things that you can accomplish together. And I'm learning so much from you. Like this whole business of doing these shows right now is kind of a learning curve and helping you figure that out. That's right. It's been a big learning curve for both of us. I mean, you know, and I've appreciated the opportunity that you gave me to help you with this project, because it helps me think about in the future, you know, if and when a time our record label has the ability to support artists in such a way, then I'd like to become a corporate sponsor for doing those types of shows that you talked about.
That'd be nice. And I will mention too, I don't know if you brought it up, but we're going to use this upcoming weekend as a time to digitally release White Lace Black Leather, correct?
Right, we are. And we got to get, I got to get to work on those tracks to make sure they're all ready to go.
So you want me to give a little bit of background on that particular disc?
Yeah, if you want to talk about it a little bit, sure, go ahead.
That album was in 1981. The lineup was Leo Nebedek, Mike Uzelak, who would stay for the next album. This was Leo's only album. There was Brent, Paul, and myself. And this particular album, White Lace Black Leather, there I go again. There was a song on it called Women, Whiskey, and Sin that we're going to be doing in the show. And it became a big hit for us in England, because England was just on the cusp of getting into that first wave of heavy metal with Iron Maiden and who else? Judas Priest, AC/DC. And so they saw the potential in us being Canada's heavy metal band. So,
wow. And so I, you know, about that time you were in your early 20s. All the guys were in their early 20s by that point in time. And so you guys were out there. Now, did you guys do the same thing with White Lace and Black Leather that you did with Breaking Loose? Did you go on a tour to support that album too?
Well, we never stopped playing. We were always playing bars. So touring, was it anything different than we didn't do before then? We were still going out through the bars, which was primarily right. Where we played. But I believe we still went down to Texas on a second tour after that album. And we didn't go to Europe, but we had success in Europe with that album. And those two albums, which were both on the H&S labels, which meant Helix and Bill Sight, those two albums led to us getting signed to Capitol EMI US. We were never signed to the Canadian label. And why that's important to note is that we would have been very hindered if we would have been signed to the Canadian label, because we would have been very restricted with money. Smaller label, smaller budget. Compared to the United States, we had 10 times the budget in the U.S. than we would have had in Canada.
Now, with that budget, there comes liabilities to the band too, right?
Liabilities in playing it back.
I'm sorry?
Liabilities, if you mean that as in regards to paying it back.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like how much, when you talk about recoupables, what does that mean?
Well, there'd be a deal. Every record contract would be different. But say back then, the standard going rate was, I think, 6 points. It meant 6 cents in the dollar. So if you did an advance of, I don't know, $100,000, do the math. 6 cents divided into 100,000 units, or $100,000 rather. That was how many units you had to sell. So in other words, okay, just doing quick math, right? Say it was 10 cents an album, which I don't think it was, but say it was 10 cents an album, right?
Right.
So, you follow me?
Yeah, I'm following you.
Most albums sold at that time were $6.99. So you're talking $1.99 per album. Divided into 100,000. So you had to sell 50,000 albums, but then we were in even more money than that. Like, I think the Rock You album alone was, the video for Rock You was $125,000.
Okay.
And then, you know, there was two more videos off that. And then there was probably, I can't remember. I think they bought our way onto the Kiss Tour in 1983. That was 35,000 US that we had to pay back.
Right.
So,
yeah, I just
Dan here again.
Yeah, I just put it up there. I just wanted people to see that. That's the artwork for White Lace and Black
Leather. That's the one that I used back in 1983, and those the girls.
That is a very, very cool piece of artwork. I like that.
You're into that type of shit, are you?
Well, you know what? I mean, I was the young guy out buying records when you guys were out playing, and oftentimes it was the album cover that was appealing to me. If I hadn't heard the band before, that's a really interesting album cover. I bet you there's really interesting music in there, right?
That album cover is drawn by Rob Yent, who's a friend of Kenny Higgs, who was our first sound man, and then later on became our road manager for many years. And then Kenny went from us to, I think, Green Jelly, Indigo Girls, West Southridge.
Okay.
We were Mac, the Indianapolis Colts.
So that's who did the artwork for that one?
No, Kenny's friend, Rob. Yeah, although Kenny was an art student. Kenny was into, who did, Roger Dean did the artwork for Yes.
Okay.
Right? And yep. Kenny was into Roger Dean. In fact, the first Helix logo, if you go right back and research it, the H was like Roger Dean would have drawn that, right? And then changed the H, but they basically kept a lot of Kenny's design when they made the final Helix logo.
Right. I mean, what I find really interesting, so the White Lace and Black Leather album, who's responsible primarily for the artwork on the front of that?
Well, I think it was my idea. I can't quite remember. I think it was my idea, but it was Rob Yent that did the album cover. And it was about a girl I met once, a little Jewish girl that...
she'll remain unnamed.
A little Bo Peep on the outside, and inside was the devil.
Oh, there we go. I just want to go back to it again, because I think it's a really interesting piece of artwork. So I want to put it up there because I think it's pretty cool. I think it's worth putting up there. So that is looks like a riding crop to me, yeah. And a garter. There's some interesting connotations in that album.
Who's using the whip and who? That's what I want to know.
Yeah, and the light and the shade.
You know, it depends who's using the whip. If it's
the black and white contrast.
As a girl, it's okay.
I mean, to me, the black and white contrast in itself is appealing. The way that the artwork is done, the fade of the black into the white, or the white into the black, right? Either way, there's a whole lot of connotations you could take from that. Just like this one here, and this is the other one that I wanted to comment on. Who did the artwork for that?
Same person, Rob. Yeah.
I mean, what a great. You know, a break in the chain, breaking loose. I mean, kind of cool. I mean, it was your debut album.
Yeah, I like the look of that album. And I used to had door handles down in Planet Helix that looked like that chain right there. There were door handles, and I made them out of chain. And it was like the first album cover.
You know, the interesting thing about that whole album is that there's not a bad song on that album, and they're all good songs, really well-written songs.
Yes, I think we were searching for identity then. You know, there's quite a few styles we covered there, everything from, like, I don't know, kind of the beginning of speed metal to little poppy songs. So, but I look back at it with a lot of fondness and smiles because we were just starting off as writers, and so... You know, we didn't have all this junk in our heads of where we thought songs should be going. We just wrote because we made us happy.
It's interesting, though, and we talked about this once before about how different all the songs are on the album. Some really, really great, well-written songs. Songs that got you guys' attention by record labels. Songs like Billy Oxygen are on that album.
Yep.
And... and you're gonna and people are that are coming to the show are gonna hear the story behind Billy Oxygen.
Yes, because it starts off at the Aeolian Hall with Brent talking about Billy Oxygen, how the song came about.
Yeah.
And then it fades out of that piece of film into us actually playing on stage.
So it's gonna be a really I think it's gonna be a real cool cool time spent with Helix, getting to know you guys more, and finding more about the band's history. So anybody that's followed you for any length of time is in for a real treat if they come to the show, because they're going to get some of that history lesson while they're there.
There's going to be a lot of people associated with the bands out at the Aeolian show, especially guys like Snake and Connie's coming out, I think, and Ken Haig. Because this band was always like a family. If you were in that inner group of people, like, we were very tight and we looked out for one another. I looked at other bands throughout my career, and they didn't have that love, shall we say.
Right.
I saw too many bands that let, for instance, drug abuse go to the point where it killed a band member, where it was almost foreseeable it was going to happen, and nobody said anything. But we were never a band like that. We would, if someone looked like they had a problem, or, you know, even being rude to fans. If we had a member of the band that said something off to a fan and some other member of the band heard him, we'd have everybody kind of, that way it kept everybody in check, and you kept an even ship. And we disciplined ourselves. And we might have seemed like out of control, friggin' drug crazed, whatever, right? But really, we were a business, and we had standards that we lived by. And like I said, honesty, integrity, hard work, all that corny stuff that you heard from your parents that was ingrained in this band. We were German descent, and that diamond square-headed friggin' attitude there, and we lived by it.
And you, I bet it was because you guys were so serious about what you wanted to do. All of you guys had made up your minds that you wanted to make your living doing music.
Yes, we were very focused on the goal. And that was to be, I tell this story in my first book, but one of the early meetings we had with William Sipe, Bill Sipe, was our manager was at Bruce Arnold's house in Weber Street in Kitchener. And I'll never forget, we were in the basement, and they're all kidding around and stuff. Everybody's getting to know each other. And for us, it was like, wow, this guy wants to be our manager, right?
Right.
Suddenly, Sipe got really, really serious. He goes, I want anybody that doesn't think we're going to be a world-class band and make it to leave. And we all went, oh, no, no. It was like the Last Supper with Jesus Christ, right? Nobody wanted to say, no, it's me. I'm going to go, right? So, like, you know, of course, I go, oh, I'm here for the long term, right? I want to get to be a world-class band, and I think I'm the only person left for that meeting.
Right. It's funny, you know, you go back to those days and when you were working as a band back in the day and you were serious about what you were doing, you started off, before you got any support under you, you started off doing all that stuff yourselves. You were chief cooks and bottle washers and, you know, the jack of all trades, master of some.
Well, no, not actually. But when we started with Bruce Arnold, did a lot of that. And I think, you know, maybe Bruce, when Bill got there, because the duties were taken away from him, maybe he felt he wasn't needed as much. I don't know. He met his wife at that time period, too.
Right. I mean, you guys had support people out there booking shows for you. But at the same point in time, you guys had regular band meetings, too, right?
That was Bill Sipkin got that. That was having a good manager. That's what having a good manager is all about. You don't listen to your manager, why have a manager? Right. Now, a lot of times, though, you know, bands end up not liking their manager because bands, traditionally, artists, right, think they're outside the laws that everybody else has to live in. Like the laws of finance, the laws, you know.
Yeah.
I always got along good with Bill because I
Having a manager is that means having somebody that brings you all back down and grounds you again.
Well, not only that, but somebody's going to tell you the truth. If you only made $100 this week, you can't make twice that amount in your paycheck.
Right.
And people go, what do you mean? I'm starving. What am I supposed to do? Like, a manager isn't the money, isn't the bank. The manager is the guy to direct your, to plot your direction.
So with many independent artists out there lacking a manager who are self-managed, what's your advice to them?
Well, first off, you got to get somebody probably that's starting at your level. Although, in certain instances in our career, like Sipe had been in a rock band and in a what was called a show band. Right. Wore the same suits. He did kicks and stuff the same, and they had a very choreographed show. It was, they knew what they were saying between songs. They did it every night the same way, right? And they get paid good money. They play the A circuit, and you know, rock bands on the other hand, they dressed in bell bottoms and t-shirts or Sergeant Pepper friggin' coats and long hair and mustaches, and sometimes they're stoned, and you know what I mean? Like, they played the B rooms and they play rock and roll. Okay. When Sipe joined the band, or when Sipe became our manager, I should say, he made Helix a hybrid of both, which was unseen on the Canadian bar. So like, people had never seen a rock band that moved around. Rock band, they spit like this, playing good guitar. They didn't move.
Much less a guitar player who lays on their back on the stage.
Sipe was brilliant. He was a very, very high IQ. He had a presence to very simple things that other bands didn't do. For instance, he had us go out between sets and meet the whole audience. We had to, part of our job was to go, we had sections. We had the room divided into sections, and it was our job to go up to ask every table what they wanted to hear, right? And start a conversation, make friends. We were also, every one of us, was to go at first time in on a Monday afternoon. You come into a strange hotel, right? Saying to turn your phone off here. Come into a strange hotel. We'll just turn.
You're getting all kinds of messages there, buddy.
Maybe. Off.
Maybe tonight.
A strange hotel on a Monday night, and a Monday afternoon, rather, and we had to go up and introduce ourselves to all the staff. And the reasoning there was the staff talked to more people than you'll ever talk to. And they're more friends with everybody in the bar than you'll ever be. So the last thing you wanted them to be doing is talking negatively about the band. We started a newsletter back then, as I was talking about last time we talked.
Right, the Heliograph.
We had a very close connection, very grassroots following with their fans. And we try to continue that today on social media. But we're different, you know, we're dealing with a different generation of people for one thing. Yep. And I find as we get older, I have to adapt simply because our audience is getting older. Some of them are dying. I know that's funny, you know, some of us are dying too, right? So
we've seen that happen. We've seen that happen. And it's changing the landscape of what artists are doing and those that want to stay doing music as long as they can do music. I mean, you know,
that's right. Like, I feel I'm still able to do it, so I'm going to continue doing it. But there's two guys in the original lineup, Ron Watson and Don Simmons, that passed away last year. And so they're gone. Lots of people in business I've known, Kevin DeBrow, Frankie Benelli, Jerry Doucette.
I think your voice has just matured over the years, you know. You settled into it.
I've been lucky because I had good technique. It was taught to me by Ed Johnson, Bel Canto, as you know.
Right. Yeah. Well, you.
I had practice yesterday from 7 o'clock in the morning. 11 o'clock in the morning rather, until I think 4 or 5 in the afternoon, and I feel great today.
I want you to teach. I want you to teach me your breathing technique because I hear it's really good.
It is really good. It's the best.
Yeah, so I want you to come over here sometime and spend some time with me and help me with that breathing technique. That'd be fun.
I can teach you how to breathe with your diaphragm.
That would be fun to do. Yeah. So here we are. We've got this other follow up album that came out in 1981. We got White Lace and Black Leather, which was the follow up album to the first album, being Breaking Loose. Tell me about that. That time with those two albums out, right? You guys had a unique marketing strategy during your shows with your albums.
Well, I had a unique marketing strategy. that And Saipi had said to us, he said, look, you know, you get so much per album. I forgot what it was now, right? But if you sell so many per week, you get double that amount, right? I'll give you double money. So right. What I do is I go out and make, before I even got to that number, I get people deals, right? So I get them to buy the album. So I'd always make my quote and get double the money.
Right.
But selling all those albums once again led to us eventually getting signed to Capitoline Live. We could prove that, you know, we had sold so many albums.
And that you guys had sold I heard that you guys had sold in excess of 10,000 units.
That's true. Between that and I think it was called a Treble Clef distribution in the United States. I know there was a little distribution company we were with as well in the United States at that time. And somebody over in England, I actually think that over the European one was a Treble Clef. But anyway, through various sources, but mostly off stage, that's where we sold the bulk of our albums.
Now, did you have any record stores pick up those first two albums at all?
Well, I used to also, when we stayed in Edmonton, okay. I used to go around all the record stores and try to get albums put in there on spec.
Right.
And I'd come back the next time we played town and I'd try to go around again, right? It was a hard road to hoe, as they say. But oddly enough, I made some friends I still have to this day. I know one friend, Kevin Noonan, he's out in Penticton, and I met him at... I don't know, it was some type of stereo shop back then that had a record department. So,
right. And so when you guys were, you know, primarily selling your albums at shows and what was your profit margin on them back then?
On the record?
Yeah. What was your profit margin?
I didn't quite get what you mean. Like,
you sold the album sold for how much and what was your cost into the album?
Oh, God, I don't know. I think back then we spent a lot of money making albums. It was like $24,000 or something.
Right. So now, but when you sell,
that's more than it is today.
So like, what did the record retail for at that time?
It'd be what everything else was in the store, $6.99. But yeah, we sold at the gigs for, I don't know, $5, I think.
And so when you sold those for like $6.99, for example.
No, I think those were the ones in the store. I'm pretty sure the ones in the bar we sold for like $5.
Okay, so you sold albums for $5. How much were you making off each album when you sold them for $5?
Well, I was making what Saipi gave me back. The rest of them went into the band Kitty.
Right.
So I don't know, really. Like, you know, I don't know. We
right.
spent
so,
probably $24,000 recording it, and then we had to spend so much pressing. I don't remember what pressing was back then, but
and you guys had huge family support behind you when you guys went to record, didn't you?
Yeah, I had my parents, my grandmother, Brent's parents, Bill Sight's parents. Bill Sight put money in himself.
How did that feel to have all those people supporting what you were doing?
Good, but it felt, I just hoped the hell I could pay them back.
It was probably a bit of fear in there too, right? Because like the fear of, okay, we're always afraid we might not sell these.
I don't think that ever occurred to me. I just, I used to hate going to my parents for everything, you know?
Mm.
Once again, different generation.
Well, it's interesting though, because, you know, I can think of, I grew up in that same generation and my parents were very much like that. They believed in investing in their kids.
Yeah. My old man believed in, once you left home, then you're on your own, baby. but you know, on the other hand, you know, my dad, my parents were supportive. They gave me money for that album. So obviously what he said, what he did were two different things.
Yeah, there's. You
know, I tried not to go to my dad unless I absolutely had to go to my dad.
Right.
Mostly my dad. You know, I spoke to my mom.
Right. It's interesting because you know, in later life, there's that payback part, and I love the payback part because I love seeing my dad. So, you know.
No, I love seeing my parents too. But my dad and I sometimes would argue.
Yeah, well, my dad is the only one left, so you know I see him when I can, and I enjoy every single visit with him. So, it's It's kind of cool when you reflect back on it. You go, he'll look at me. He goes, "You do so much for me now," and I'm like, "Yeah, but you did so much for me when I was younger. It's called payback."
Well, I'll tell you, maybe next time we do this, like we'll do it from out in the garage. Well, we'll do it from my laptop because I got my garage made out like a man cave.
That'd be cool.
And one of my favorite pictures is my dad. He's riding, I think, a cockshot 30. It's a cockshot, though, for sure, because my dad worked for cockshot implements just outside of Kitchener. My uncle, Carl, owned the dealership.
Right.
But that particular picture, my dad did for a cockshot commercial, and he was driving because my dad was a real farmer.
Very cool.
He could take that damn tractor down the block. He used to take our tractors down and all our equipment. He got in bits and pieces like the Johnny Cash song, only he told us, obviously his brother knew about it, but he'd find bits and pieces, seed drills, harrows, cultivators, you name it, and bring it home and piece it back together and be a usable machine on the farm.
And you grew up in a farming community, right?
I grew up on a farm.
Right.
Hell of a community. My community. I went to a little Catholic church or Catholic school, Catholic church. Walked school sometimes. Walked home. 3 miles. Wow. Milk cows. I was 6.
3 miles uphill in your father's pajamas in the snow.
And we tried to get your milk cow ahead.
I have done that.
It's harder than it looks.
It is harder than it looks. It's not an easy task.
You never forget, like riding a bicycle.
Yeah. Once you learn how to milk a cow, you never forget it.
Well, once you've had that otter, there's no other.
I remember learning how to milk cows at my uncle's. He says, "Get over here. I got to show you how to, I want to teach you something." And I'm like, "Okay." And he taught me how to milk a cow.
Oh, yeah. I thought you
were. And the cats would always come over and you'd squirt the cat and the cat would be, you know, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, they'd stand right up in their hind legs.
Oh yeah, they'd be all over that for all sure.
Shoot right in their face.
Yep. No. Yeah. Happy memories for sure. So you guys were constantly on the road. How many dates a year do you think you were playing at that time?
There was 1 year we played over 300 dates. I know it sounds incredible.
That's busy for a band.
Mm-hmm. But while on the streets tour, we started off that tour at 41 nighters straight. One nighters. 40.
41 nighters.
41 nighters. We started in the First Avenue Club in Minneapolis, Prince's Club, and we ended off in Louisville, Kentucky.
And so what year would that been, Brian?
1987.
Okay, so we're now we've moved past the 79. We're into the 80s now in terms of what the band's doing. Now, at that point in time, you guys are, by then, you're with the label, right?
Well, we were 83. We were signed to Capitol Records, EMI.
Right. So who was booking you guys for all those shows in the States then?
ICM.
And so they were a booking agency working for the record label or what?
No, working for us.
Working for you, trying to get you shows here, there, and everywhere.
See, that's a misconception by the public. The record label, very rarely that I saw, I got involved with tours and stuff like that. Like, they coordinated. Like, if you were coming to town, they coordinate having your rep go and stuff. But as for putting stuff together or putting bands, if you're on labels together and that, I didn't see that happening. Like, I didn't see us being put on WAFs or Iron Maiden tours because we're on the same label. Because think about it. Where's the benefit to the promoter to help the record company out?
Right. Yeah, and back in the days, the motivation for the promoter was a financial motivation to book really good shows and make money.
Back in the day, it still should be the motivation, make money.
Like, that's right. And hopefully do something that's going to make money for everybody. So it's a win-win for everybody, right?
Well, that's what I mean. But, you know, nothing's changed. Like, people still are in business to make money.
Yeah.
This idea, I talk to some people sometimes and they think that you're going to do something called altruism. And what a bunch of bullshit. Like, come on. Like, it doesn't work like that. And you're not going to get people around you to think like that either. Like, I'm not saying that to corrupt yourself or anything like that, but I'm just saying, do it for the right reasons and don't think it's not going to do it just for a good feeling. Like, I know you kind of do it like that, but like, you're not going to lose wads of cash either, right?
No, and you've got to function. You got to function in the reality of the real world that's out there. And if you're gonna tour, and that's where bands make their most money, is when they tour, right?
Well, and yes and no. Back then, I think that the record company would advance you money to tour, but see, they wouldn't get involved in setting up the tour,
right?
But I mean, they were involved, but they weren't involved. Like, for instance, the record company gave us $35,000 to get on the Kiss tour in 1983 in Europe, right?
Right.
But it wasn't the record company that really set that up. Like, we had to first off, I think it was us that put it into, got the wheels turning, that got, like, Sipe, got something happening with someone over there, and I don't know how it led to that, but, you know. But I didn't really see the record company forcing us on to tours like, say, with Iron Maiden. And I didn't see right. that.
So who was primarily responsible for booking your tours then, your tour dates?
It would be us in combination with Sipe, and it would be a combination of all the parties involved. The dates would come to us, for instance, ICM in the United States, right? ICM would come to us, say, Sipe, okay, we got a heart tour. Because we did several hard tours, right? Mm-hmm. I'm going to put you in there, okay? And probably at that point, they knew enough that they didn't have to go to Sipe and approve every date. They just right. go and say, okay, we got this, and you go, okay, great. Let's go, right? And
right.
then they send the contracts, and you didn't even have to wait for the contracts probably to come in because you had the power of ICM behind you. You understand?
Right. So when tours were offered to you guys back in those days when you were touring heavily, was it this idea of, we want to play this particular area, or did they put you in a specific stable and say you're going to be touring with these various artists?
No, because we played with everybody from Marshall Crenshaw to Greg Kinn to Michael Bolton to Heart. To Motorhead, like to Quarterflash,
and yeah, because you guys play with Kiss and Motorhead and lots of other bands.
That's right, all sorts of bands. It was more that first tour in 1983. Here's how smart Sipe was, right? Sipe's main motivation on that tour was to keep us in the United States so we could meet the important people involved in creating our career, i.e. the record company, i.e. Right. people at the radio stations, i.e. the local promoters, if they could see the band. That was the main reason. The secondary reason was actually to get in front of people.
Yeah, and I think being...
It became the main motivation from then on. But that first tour was to establish those connections. So say we're coming into Baltimore, right? We would have it set up, and we were phoning the radio station in advance. We're saying, look, have you got the song from the record company? If not, why not? And we'll get it sent to you. Make sure. When can we? And here's the line we always have. When can we check back with you?
When can we check back with you?
Because it forced them to go listen to the song or whatever, right?
Right.
And when we got to town, the record company come out. By this time, we'd already been down to the record stores to see if they front racked us. So if the record companies started blowing smoke up our ass in regards to, we front rack the record album, because that was important back then.
Right.
If you weren't in the front racks, how the hell did anybody know you had a product there? Right?
For sure. That was the only way, because there was no internet. There was,
That's right. you come in town and then, you know, you'd know the answer, but you just, you know, let them babble away. Sometimes they're really good, and other times they'd lie through their fucking teeth. They'd say that, you know, they'd say that they had, you know, front rack the album or something. They had this display up, and we knew damn well. You know, at that stage, we had marketing people that were actually checking each store out for us in the background that they didn't know about. So we knew that they were lying and when they were telling the truth.
What an interesting time. And again, you know, you guys, through that period of time, you know, from the first album to the second album, you guys had a bit of a lineup change in there. And there were three of you that were consistent through that era, like into 81. And that was you and Brent and Paul, right?
Correct.
Yeah, so you guys at that point in time were sort of like the core members of Helix, and then other people came in and did that second album with you, and then things started taking off in 83 and you get signed to Capitol. Mm-hmm. And how did that feel? The cool thing about you guys getting signed to an American arm of a label, being a Canadian band, it did give you a bit of a leg up. I mean, you said you got on some really great tours. You got more support, more financial support from the label. You had bigger budgets to work with, which meant that you could get your music out in front of more people or do better productions for your videos.
You have no idea what the power of money is behind you. When we were with our own label, like, there was nothing. And then suddenly we were at Capitol Records. It was like money was no object. We were flying around the country in planes to interviews, doing photo sessions that were costing a lot of money, videos that were costing a lot of money. We thought that Heavy Metal Love was an expensive video, and it was only $26,000.
Right.
Rock You was $130,000 US. And so on and so forth. So the power of the label was amazing. That's why, be careful what you wish for. When Jesus Christ, you know, the big record companies are all gone, right? But the big record companies were the bank. Right. Yeah, maybe they kind of took all the profits and that, but they also had a lot of losing acts on the label in their defense. I blame government more than anything. And I also have a pet peeve, and that is the fact that a lot of these old labels have, you know, been sold. Like Capitol, for instance, have been sold to, I think it was sold to EMI, and EMI was sold to Universal. Not quite sure of the succession, but now it's all Universal. So what was I going to get at here? I know what it is. They own the masters. But I paid for those masters throughout the years, and if I haven't paid for them, holy cow, we're talking 1983 it starts. So how many years ago is that? Like 40 something years ago. I think at some point those masters, they should have a shotgun clause. You know what a shotgun clause is?
Yeah, it ends up being
worth this much money, and like they decide, you take the record company goes, okay, I think they're worth this money. So if you don't buy them, they have to pay you. That ensures that they're going to put a fair price on those recordings.
Right. Yeah.
Be forced to license them to the, because what happens is this, the band after a while is kicked off the label or leaves the label or the whatever. Right. And then the music is discontinued. So the band, like, that's the way, the only exposure they have, so people know who the hell they are, is their music. But the record company has discontinued the friggin', the title.
Right.
And the band can't produce it.
Yeah, and that's really sad when it gets to that point. When the label decides they're not going to do anything with the music anymore, but the artist still wants to do something with the music, what's the harm to give it back to the artist? I mean, they paid for it many times over.
Well, you know, somehow there should be an equitable deal between the band and the label. I'm not saying short the label and just take it back from them, right? I'm not advocating that. because, you know, you've entered an agreement with the record company, and you do have some type of responsibility for the what you signed for.
Right.
But on the same hand, I don't think it's fair that they can just continue the music and cut off your lifeline to your making a living.
I think there should be some sort of a sunset clause in those kinds of contracts that
well, that's after another option, but there should be something in there.
Yeah.
It is right now, the record company is just keeping ownership until they go into what, the public domain? That's bullshit.
I mean, here's a novel option too going forward. If they're not going to do anything with the masters and they're not going to do any further work with the music, why not let the artist do it and just claim a percentage of those royalties?
Well, I have actually approached the label with that.
Yeah, negotiate a lifetime royalty agreement with the artist. Say, look, you want to do something with this music? We're not going to do something, but it's worth something to us because we own the masters. So here's what we'll do it. Let you do it what you want with the music for maybe a percentage of an ongoing royalty.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, I got a question here. What is the status on Pleasure Doing Business?
I got the test press the other day from Detroit, and the song was incredible.
That came in from Andy Crist. Andy Crist, and we're at the top of the hour now.
I got Andy soon up, by the way. Sorry.
Oh, no worries. So Andy Crist says, what's the status on Pleasure Doing Business? We got an album. You've got test pressings that you're listening to right now, right?
That's right. The song was incorrect.
And so,
that's why you get test pressings. Somehow something got mixed up.
When might we expect to have those units ready for sale?
Well, I don't know. If they get this done, I don't think it'll take long to figure out this problem. And then I'll have to go down probably in a couple of weeks to get down to Detroit again. And then once I approve the test process, then it's ready to go.
Hey, I got an idea. I don't know what your schedule is going to be like during that time, but maybe if you're going to go down to Detroit and pick up those records, maybe you should be hitting some record shops on the way back to London.
Maybe, but it's a long day just going down.
It is a long day down there because you don't know how long they're going to hold you up.
Records either. I can only bring back a certain amount because you got paid duty for them at the border. The rest of them shipping down to Florida and they're going to stay there.
Right. Wow. There's got to be a way around this.
Well, maybe. If I bring them back a little bit at a time, I can bring them back to Florida. Or I'll sell them there and print some more up here. I know. I'll decide in the future.
Right. Right on. All right. So I am going to, we're at the top of the hour. Did you have anything you wanted to wind up at the show with Brian? Was anything specific you wanted to share about that particular point in time?
The AOL is doing really well. We're up to 180 sold tickets as of yesterday, which is pretty good. There's only a few left because I got a lot of people I got that are special guests of mine, associates with the band and stuff.
I got to tell you something before we go. That record store, by the way, is called Records and Relics in St. Thomas.
Yes.
And Rick Leeson, the owner, you've known him for many years.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it so happens that Rick and I went to high school together.
Really?
What a small world, right?
Yeah,
so I took some tickets into Rick today. He had sold the other tickets that you had given him, and so I took some more tickets into him. And if anybody from around the St. Thomas area, you should drop into Records and Relics. They got some really cool record titles in the store. They're great.
Yeah, really, a lot of thanks for doing that for me. There was the sports place in the mall too.
Yeah, you had a sport place in the mall that's actually taking care of the ticket sales as well. So I know you gave a shout out to everybody the other day, thanking them for their support. So we got two live shows coming up this weekend with Helix at the Aeolian Hall in London, Ontario, Canada. And that's
great. And I was explaining about that, the Aeolian Hall, right? We got 180 sold tickets, but we also got 100 people on the guest list. because right. all people have been associated with the band over the years that I owe thanks to. So it's going to be a real love-in that night. And there's only a few tickets left. So grab your tickets, ladies and gentlemen, because if you don't do it in the next couple of days, you won't get one.
And that show at the Aeolian Hall this Friday night starts at 8 p.m.
Yep.
And the doors are open at 7.
I want to mention one last thing, and that's about the friggin' roads down there. Because it got all the neighborhood tore up with construction, the city. You have to, if you're coming, no matter where you're coming in from, I think you got to go south to Adelaide, and you got to cut across to Dundas and then come up Dundas that way, because Rectory's closed off. Dundas is closed off the other way. I don't know about the other side of Dundas, but you got to go down to Adelaide, I think, and come up Dundas.
So you're telling people to give themselves a little extra time when they're coming to the show tomorrow night.
For sure. And we're going to start the show a little early with a piece of film that I put together. You've seen it.
Yeah, so the show is Friday night, starting at 8 p.m. Doors open at 7:30, but you're telling people, and I think there's an idea for a short, Brian, to get out there and do a short telling people about the traffic problems in London because of the construction.
Yes, maybe I can stand it tomorrow.
Yeah, so that people can find their way to the show. What's that?
I said I should stand there with a guy in a hard hat beside me, just grimly looking into the camera.
I think we're going to need a beacon over the building so people can find it.
I should ask some worker down there if I could do that.
So show starts 8 p.m. this Friday night at the Aeolian Hall in London. Helix live and unplug with storytelling. And same thing on Sunday, the 11th. And that is at the Princess Ave Theater in St. Thomas at the Elgin Theater Guild.
2 o'clock.
2 p.m. to 4 p.m.
I'm not going peace here. I'm going 2.
And I think these shows, Helix is going to sign stuff for people after the show.
Going down the back alley, don't forget.
Yeah. Now, are the guys going to stick around for the show on Sunday? Is he going to stick around for a Q&A, or do people have to depart and go other places?
Well, it depends if the hall charges me for sitting around for an hour. You know what I mean?
Well, we can always do a Q&A back at the bar.
Yeah, we can always do a Q&A back at the bar if you want.
Yeah, might be fun.
Bar, you know, do they have a band set up there, some type of microphone or something?
We can set up a microphone so that we can do a quick Q&A if you guys want to do that. If there's people that are interested, we can do that really quickly.
Yeah, we're going to back to mingle with fans and just talking right at the tables and shit. So
that'd be fun. Fun to do that.
Like I'm sure just as long as let the guys eat the sandwich or whatever they're eating. But
right.
We're pretty easy.
And we want to thank the back alley for their support as well, because they're taking care of the band after the show.
Thank them. That was very nice of them to do that.
They've got a couple of
way to end off going down, spend time with, you know, with their fans down at the club. We love that type of stuff, you know.
I like the idea of the show being 2 o'clock in the afternoon. It can be a really cool time for people. They can go out, take in the show, go back to the back alley for some eats.
The old lady, get drunk, go to bed, wake up next morning for it.
They're offering a couple of things on the menu for cheap at that event as well. So attend the show, come back to the back alley after the show for some eats and meet the band. And so these live shows, hopefully they're going to be a fun time for all of us. And we'll see you folks later. Brian will be hopefully... I know we're going to be able to do this one next month, because him and I'll talk about this afterwards. And, but we want to thank everybody for joining us tonight. From myself, I am Kenny, and you are not. And that is Brian Vollmer. That's Brian Vollmer. And you're not him either. Have a great night, everybody.
You too, Ken.